became a household name in Australia as the resident heartthrob in Skippy the Bush Kangaroo. Tony Bonner is now 75 and has had a rich career in both film and TV. And these days, when he's not acting, he's a proud grandfather, a mentor to young actors, and plays a key role as president at the Manly Surf Lifesaving Club in Sydney. But his past wasn't always smooth sailing. Ahead of writing his memoir, Tony Bonner sat down with our very own Craig Bennet for this exclusive and candid interview.
He's a veteran actor celebrating 60 stellar years in showbiz. But with almost 100 theatre, TV and movie credits to his name, understandably, it can be a challenge for Tony Bonner to pinpoint his very first role.
Do you remember your first acting role?
I don't really. I should have chronicled or journaled a lot of things in my life, but I didn't think I'd ever make this age, Craig, in all honesty.
I remember seeing you in a wonderful Aussie movie called They're a Weird Mob. You played a lifesaver. Do you remember that?
Yeah, like it was yesterday. It was a great part of the film industry to be in back then in those early 60s. It was a wonderful film and it's still great.
Tony was only 24 when he became world famous as the hunky helicopter pilot Jerry King in the Aussie TV sensation Skippy.
That came about because of They're a Weird Mob. The producers of They're a Weird Mob then became the producers of Skippy.
Well, I mean, of course, they saw you in your speedos.
Now, if we had a couple of dolls up there to make all the difference.
You and your dolls, we represent Australian wildlife, not Bondi Beach.
I said, what's it being shot on? He said, we're shooting it on colour film. And I thought, holy moly.
Did you really fly the helicopter?
I did, in a sense. Jim Ferguson, who was the pilot and owner of that lovely old Bell, he sat in the passenger seat with dual controls. So I sat in the pilot seat, looking like I was flying it. We had, used to have a camera set about there, and then we'd shoot the sequence. Now in my combat. When we finished this sequencing, and we're heading back to the helipad, you say, away you go. And so I'd have a crack at it, and it was great. I loved it.
Tony also let slip some surprising Skippy secrets, like how the world's most famous bush kangaroo managed to notch up so many fabulous feats.
One kangaroo looks like any other kangaroo. So you kind of break the tricks up and you use this particular kangaroo to do this and this particular kangaroo to do that. And if all else failed, Craig, as you full well know, you had the little bottle openers to do the rest.
Skippy!
Did you love making Skippy? I mean, the cast all seemed to get on wonderfully.
Ed and I were great mates. I didn't know Ken really at that stage, young Ken James, or Gary that played Sonny. They were two young actors that kind of joined the cast. Lisa Goddard came into the show after about the fourth or fifth episode because the producers and I suppose the network felt that they needed a girl in the show to break up all the guys.
Now, a little birdie told me that you two were very close friends. Really close friends. I mean, very well.
Yeah, we were good mates and still are.
You better get going, Jerry. She could be badly hurt.
Now, Tony, people think that you're in the show from the beginning to the end, but that's not quite true, is it?
I did the first year and then had a disagreement. So I said, well, OK, if that's the way it is, I wish you all well and see you later. They didn't think I'd leave because the show was so successful. So I jumped off the deep end and flew to London. They just didn't mention that I wasn't in the show.
After Skippy, Tony got to work with some of the world's biggest stars. He nabbed a role in The Persuaders alongside the great Roger Moore and Tony Curtis. Tony's career took him to Tinseltown, where he dropped by Cabot Cove to guest star opposite Angela Lansbury in Murder, She Wrote. In the 80s, Tony returned home, bringing the hunky Tom Selleck with him to film Quigley Down Under.
What was it like to be a sex symbol?
I suppose, Craig.
Having never been a sex symbol, I'm eager to know, Tony.
No. It was, well, there was nothing else on. I mean, I suppose I was the only game in town.
He was handsome, successful, talented, and adored by millions of fans all over the world. But privately, Tony was dealing with crushing insecurities and a ferocious battle with the bottle that cost him the role of a lifetime.
I was on the drink probably a bit too much back then, and it was the moments between when I was working that were my problems.
You could have been James Bond, as in 007.
They asked me to come up to London. They asked Roger Moore to come up, because we were on the same shoot at Pinewood. And then we were going to go to Los Angeles from London to do a screen test. I've got quite low self-esteem, and I just thought, can I play Bond? I mean, not from the sense of the actor playing Bond, but can Tony Bonner become this unbelievable international person? It kind of worried me. A friend of mine owned a bar on the island of Ibiza, and I scooted down there to Santa Eulalia del Rio and kind of got drunk down there for a month and didn't go on to do the test. Roger went and did it and obviously got the gig. And Roger would say to me every time I'd see him or talk to him after that, you know, he'd always say, dear boy, what happened to you? And what happened to me was low self-esteem. I had a reasonably tough childhood. Not that I ever blamed my dad for the dramas in the household.
It was tumultuous, wasn't it?
Yeah. And it revolved around alcohol. So one would have thought when I got out of there, I'd be about the last person to pick up a drink. And yet, 14, as most alcoholics start their journey, I picked up a first drink, and that seemed to help the low self-esteem a bit. That was the monkey on my back for the next kind of 40 years.
What was absolute rock bottom for you?
Oh, I mean, it was bad, you know. It's part of the reason I can't write my biography. A great friend and writer, Matthew Condon, is writing that at the moment.
Too painful for you?
Oh, not so much that. I'm a big boy now. I can cop on the chin what I need to cop on the chin and have in the last 30 years of sobriety. I just had too many blackouts. I just had too many moments that I don't remember. I mean, I was in places and lived with people and travelled to countries that I don't remember.
You told me you'd wind up sleeping in friends' gazebos. You'd just crash wherever you could.
My ex-wife, Nola, never really knew where I was, or she kind of knew I wasn't having an affair with anyone. My affair was with the bottle. The only thing that kept me alive was this industry. It was a family, and still is. I regard everyone, you, the guys on this crew, as a part of me and my family, and always have.
The booze nearly killed him, but it was in hospital that Tony experienced a spiritual awakening that turned his life around.
I had three young daughters at this stage, and this kind of voice clearly said, you're not going to see these girls grow up. So I came out of the fever I had, and I got out of that hospital, and I just needed to do something about the manner in which I was living. So I did.
Now, Tony, you hold the distinction of being the first Australian to pose nude for Cosmopolitan magazine. That was 1972. Burt Reynolds was doing it in America, and you did it here. Were you nervous when they said to you, Tony Bonner, we want you to drop everything?
I wasn't really, because the guy that was doing the photography is a great old mate of mine.
So he'd make sure your bits were covered?
Oh, absolutely.
Tony, it's been lovely chatting with you, and thank you so much for being so candid.
Just the way I am.
Happy music there by Craig Bennet, and Tony's memoir is coming out later this year. He told Craig it was really confronting telling everything about his life, but he wanted it to be the truth.